Thank you, Gilles, for the introduction. Thank you, everyone, for being here. I have to say that coming to Japan is always a great pleasure. I enjoy it very much here. I also am very happy that I can give this opening talk here because of the following. Now I have to find which button to press this one. No, that doesn't work. I have to press here. Okay. So the following fact, I think it's totally fair to state that a quantum technology area has started. And I think that I would not have said that a year ago in Paris. I think what we have seen since a year is quite tremendous and changes the landscape in which we work. Now, I'm going to elaborate on that, but let's also look at the consequences of that statement. And one of the first consequences of that statement is that in 10 years, either QKD will have found its market or it will be dead. Now, in 10 years, we'll know whether we as a community will have made something and have a success or whether we have to move to something different. And I also think that this statement implies that each of us has the choice between merely witnessing a revolution, because this is a revolution, so we can either merely witness that revolution or be an actor of this revolution. So now, why is this quantum technology revolution happening now and really taking off now? And there are really two changes. There are changes in technologies and there are changes in perception. And the change in perception, we already heard about that this morning, is illustrated by this announcement by the NSA, the American NSA, that writes that a transition to quantum-resistant algorithm in the not-too-distant future has now to be launched, initiated. That's an enormous statement, and the NSA is certainly well-informed, and very clearly they believe in the quantum computer. And that is really what is driving now this entire field. On the technology side, we really have now, whether it is with superconducting qubits, with ions in linear ion traps, or with electrons electron spins in diamonds, we are at a situation where we can perform error correction and have logical qubits. So here it is written in this roadmap, is written logical memories, but think of logical qubits that have a longer lifetime than physical qubits. So this is really the essential step that we are doing now towards this fault-tolerant quantum computation. And this is happening with different technologies, the three I have mentioned and some others. And once you have that logical qubit, as written here, when you can do the single operation, that's quite easy, when you do a entanglement, teleportation, and so on, and eventually this fault-tolerant quantum computation. And actually, some people are really already jumping to that final goal using this surface code, which seemed to be a very efficient way of doing fault-tolerant computation. There are other changes in technologies. First, because of that step, for classical cryptography, it is time to panic. So there are other changes in technology. One that we know well in our community is about the detectors, these superconducting nanowires that achieve remarkable efficiencies and that everyone now worldwide is developing and working on and using. Another example of the change of technology is this experiment of quantum teleportation from a telecom wavelength photon to a solid state quantum memory. I will come back to that one in half an hour, more or less. Now, the fact that we have entered this quantum technology area means that the concept of quantum-safe crypto is becoming central. That's a central theme. And by quantum-safe crypto, one means everything which is resistant to known classical and quantum attacks. Okay? And there are, as you see, two ways towards quantum-safe crypto. One way is called post-quantum crypto. And by post-quantum crypto, what is meant is complexity-based classical algorithm. So essentially, the idea is that instead of basing the security on the difficulty of factoring, you're going to base it on some other difficulties, some problems in lattice theory or in other problems, other classical problems. And that's one possibility. The alternative, I don't need to introduce here, is QKD. And which one is going to win is not clear today. Let's look at the pros and cons. On the post-quantum crypto side, one of the very high pluses is that you don't need to change much for the security experts. You know, all around the world, there are security experts in banks, industries, governments, everywhere, agencies. And all these people, they know their business. They know their job, of course. Going from, let's say, RSA to some lattice-based crypto thing or anything else doesn't change much for them. It's the same kind of box. They're talking to the same kind of people. They have the same kind of procedure. Not much changes for them. And that's an enormous advantage for post-quantum crypto. On the other side, just changing the algorithm is again a wild bet on the unknown, because you have to bet that another problem, manufacturing, is difficult. And how do you know that it is really difficult? You try, and then you have at some point to make a bet. Another point against post-quantum crypto is this vulnerability backwards. You know very well that today everything gets recorded. And even if there's some progress in the future, there will be a possibility to decode backwards in time, to decode what is exchanged today. And that would remain if we go to post-quantum cryptography. On the QKD side, we have provable security, which is certainly a great plus. And we have also backward security. So even if some glitch is found in some implementation in the future, that doesn't put in danger anything in the past. However, there are also some drawbacks. One is that it is still relatively expensive. Of course, the price would go down if it becomes a larger market, but it is expensive. And the second, I think, major con is that it implies big changes in infrastructure and in mentality. You have to change the infrastructure. You need these dedicated fibers, so you need to multiplex a quantum channel with classical channels, which is very challenging. And in mentality, this is also what Grégoire Ribordy was mentioning this morning. The classical crypto community doesn't like quantum because they don't really understand it, because it's not really their speciality. But it's very understandable that they don't like it, but so you need to overcome this mental barrier, which is a big challenge. Okay, so there is a competition. And who is going to win? No one knows today. What I believe today is that it's likely that each will find some applications. And the real question is about the size of each market. Another point, which is, I think, very important, we should always keep in mind, that everyone needs true random bits. And when I say true random bits, I'm, of course, thinking of quantum random bits. And this is also the case for post-quantum cryptography. So whenever you hear someone talking about post-quantum cryptography and saying all the nasty things they say about us, ask a question about randomness, because we know very well that they have a problem with randomness. And the only solution, proper solution, is quantum randomness. Okay, so here is again a slide which illustrates this quantum technology revolution. We already heard about this standardization workshop that will take place actually next week on this quantum safe crypto, which really has both aspects in it. We also already saw that in China, one is very active. In Korea, a lot is going on. In the UK, a lot is going on. The next talk will tell us what is going on in the US. But I think here, I have to tell you the following, namely that RSA is de facto dead. I think that again is an enormous statement. Not everyone will agree with that, but the NSA does. And the NSA is actually setting the rules in that game. And that's an enormous change. Again, that no one could have stated that a year ago. I'm not going to speak much about quantum communication in space. We had a little bit of that this morning for those who were already here, but we should not forget that this is also a very active and promising field. Let's now just remember, what does actually QKD achieve? Of course, we all know it, but I think it's good to summarize that. Attacks have to be launched on the spot. Hence, it is immune to future progress. This is an enormous advantage. We should not forget to use that when selling or promoting our field. And now, with only the assumption of proper implementation, we have key expansion. Why key expansion? Because we still need an initial secret key for authentication. However, if we only assume short-term secure one-way function, you know, some one-way function that would take more than a minute or a few seconds to decode, to invert. So I'm not talking about long-term security, really, just short-term security. That is already enough that to provide quantum key distribution with long-term security. So the assumption is really kind of minimal. Now, if you complement QKD with one-time pad, then you really have information theoretical long-term security. And if you combine QKD with AES, which is a solution which is implemented today in all commercial systems or systems that are developed with a commercial perspective, it is still interesting, although we lose formally the information security, is that you get limited data available for decoding, because when the key is changed after a few seconds. And also you get limited motivation for an adversary, because if the adversary breaks one key, he will get only a few seconds of data, not really all the data. Quantum hacking. That is also a point which has already been mentioned, comes always again. So here you have a picture of Lars Linderson, who was a student of Vadim Makarov. And a picture was taken when he was in actually one of my lab at Geneva University doing some hacking on this QKD system, a blinding attack on that. And you see that he really had access to everything, really have access everywhere, has a scope, power meters, everything, can have this kind of full access to the box. So I would say that this was a very interesting kind of contribution to the field, and is still ongoing and will continue. But quantum attack is maybe actually a science fiction attack, because if you give this kind of access to a crypto box, to a cryptographic box to anyone, of course security is gone. And I would really like to see attacks that are done on a system which is running, you know, live. And that is extremely difficult, because these different detectors which are here in, they're not exactly all equivalent. They have various different capacities and so on. And so it's not that easy to really just do it from a distance. It's much easier to do it like that. And anyway, we should remember that there is nothing like cracking QKD. Or the principle of QKD will never be attacked. Only some implementations may be faulty. And the fact that the implementation has to be checked is not something which is specific to quantum key distribution. Of course, the classical systems and the classical implementations have also to be tested and are tested and are often found guilty. From this point of view, a very recent news is quite interesting to us. Okay, here I start with this Quanta magazine that writes, didn't really understand that, Britain Electronic Surveillance Agency posted an enigmatic paper, so that's my underline, online that calls into question the security of some of the most promising lattice-based schemes. So these lattice-based schemes that was supposed to be the most promising post-quantum crypto algorithm seems to be vulnerable to quantum attacks. And you see, this is not even a month old. So I'm not a specialist. I cannot tell you whether this paper is exactly correct or partially correct. But the kind of putting in question also the security of these post-quantum crypto algorithms is certainly something that people are doing and people are working on, and is of very high interest. Now, how can you mitigate these quantum hacking attacks? And here, let me tell you of this paper that was published last May, and which proposes a detector with variable efficiency. And so the idea behind that kind of countermeasure is very similar to the very well-known decoy states, you know, that decoy states mitigate the use of pseudo-single photons. And in the same way, this decoy detector mitigates blinding attack on single photon detectors. So the idea is pretty simple. You have a random choice, so Bob randomly chooses the detection efficiency when he detects his single photons. And now Eve, or Linderson, or Makarov, whoever, has to reproduce unknown detection efficiency. We don't know which efficiency we have to mimic. Exactly the same as for the detector, the decoy state. So this is not straightforward to implement because you have to vary this efficiency, but it is feasible. There is also a poster here at the conference which shows that the very simple idea of just suppressing some gates, having only two levels, let's say zero and a finite value for these efficiencies is not sufficient. You have to do something more sophisticated. One possible implementation, which is pretty simple, would be to have your photon coming here into Bob, and before the detector have a 90-10% coupler, so that 90% of the photons will go to this detector and 10% to that one. So blinding such a detector, you need a lot of light coming in so that you have enough to blind that one, but then you have plenty of on this one, so it's very difficult to monitor that one if you blind that one. And if you monitor the one, you cannot blind the other one. And this kind of 90-10 detector is actually, it's more a coincidence, but is a fact, is actually at the core of Bob in this coherent one-way protocol that we have developed in Geneva, because here we take actually 90% of the photons to go to this detector, which is actually our data line. That's where we measure the quantum bit error rate and from which we are going to produce the rho key. And here we take 10% with this interferometer to measure the visibility, to do somehow the measurement in the other bases, in the complementary bases. And so this is a kind of scheme, detection scheme, very difficult to blind. Okay, now with this kind of system, and you will have a talk on that by Hugo Sbinden, which is actually the last talk of this conference. He will present you that in more detail, so QKD over the 700 kilometers with finite key analysis. And a remarkable point here is that it uses InGaAs, so semiconductor detectors, not superconducting detectors. And from this kind of result and knowing what is seems to be feasible, I think, again, it is fair to say that a vision of a QKD engine producing 1 gigabit per second of provably secret bits is on the horizon. So again, I mean, QKD is well known for being slow. It is still slow today, relatively slow, even if we talk now in terms of megabits per second. But there is no reason to think that we are going to stay there. I mean, gigabits is going to be complicated. It's no longer pure physics. That becomes more and more technology. But there is nothing fundamental that should stop us from thinking of QKD with gigabits provable secure keys at the end. Of course, it means that the rates at the source side must be even much larger. Random numbers. I already told you that random numbers are extremely important. Mind you, random numbers. That was also emphasized, for instance, here by BBC. I could have found many other examples. I mean, Snowden really changed the perception we have of random numbers. We know today that actually some agencies were playing with a pseudo random number generator that were actually only pseudo and not random. And this is a real point for where quantum physics and quantum technology can provide a solution. And indeed, we need a complete solution. We don't need only, let's say, this kind of picture, which is certainly at the core, just a beam splitter and two detectors. You've all seen this kind of picture already. But a complete solution is much more than that, and it implies key management. So let me here come to a more conceptual part of my presentation. When you have a finite random sequence, it's just impossible to prove that it is randomness, that it is random, if you base your definition of randomness on Kolmogorov complexity. You know, it's impossible to write a program which is short of and the sequence and reproduces that sequence. However, it is possible to prove the existence of random processes. Now, in quantum physics, we don't have actually directly, we don't produce random bits. We have a random process. It's a process that runs in time and produces bits with certain probabilities. So that's a process. And if you have a random process, then there is a theorem, which is extremely intuitive, saying that a random process produces with unit probability a sequence of maximum complexity. So if you use a quantum process, like these photons on a beam splitter, you know that with probability one, you are producing a sequence which will be impossible to compress, which has maximal Kolmogorov complexity. Once you have that, you can go to certify your quantum random number generator. Here, I like always to show that because it's done by the Agence Nationale de la Sécurité des Systèmes d'Information from the République Française. So it sounds extremely serious, maybe more than that one. But anyway, there are more of these certificates and so on. And if you like to know more about that, go to Grégoire Ribordy. How could you also make it more compact, this random number generator? And here there are several possibilities. One that we proposed last year, Bruno Sanguinetti and co-workers, is actually just to illuminate the sensor of an iPhone or any kind of phone, so one of these phones. Actually, it was a Nokia phone because it was easier to get access to the sensor here. And these sensors are of such high quality that the technical noise, this noise, is actually smaller than the noise coming from the fact that you have a coherent state, the illumination here. So really, the shot noise produces more randomness than the technical noise, as you can see from that kind of picture. And so you can then extract quantum randomness just by having the sensor of your phone illuminated. Find that very fascinating, and this is something which is also under further development. Another possibility is to go to Professor Morgan Mitchell from ICFO in Barcelona and get one of his big boxes that produces fresh and pure quantum random number for loophole-free Bell tests. And so here the idea behind this kind of quantum random number generator is to have pulses coming from this laser here. And so in between the pulses, you go below the threshold of lasing. So each of these pulses is a new pulse generated by a new spontaneous emission, which comes with a random phase. And this phase can then be measured thanks to these kind of interferometers. And then you can have this fast random number generator. And using this kind of fast random number generator, you have this result. I just heard before my talk that actually they got a post-deadline paper. But Ronald told me actually that there was no one coming here from QTech and asked me to make a small presentation here. So I will do a 2-minute presentation, and the 25-minute presentation will be on Friday by I don't know whom. So what we did at QTech in Delft, the Netherlands, so use this random number generator to perform measurements on these electron spins in diamond. And these measurements were done only once, or were collected only if we get the heralding signal from the central station. You know, this is the central station. This is one part of their campus. The other part of the campus separated by more than 1 kilometer here. And so the principle, well, first on the technology side, you see that we have extremely high control of these spins. Okay, that's a scheme of these diamonds with this NV center here. That's how it looks like. And we have excellent spectroscopic results. You see that the peaks are very clearly and easily identified, which allows them to do proper spin initialization. And then in terms of the space-like diagram, so C is not exactly in the middle, as you can see here. So we do send the photons, so a photon entangled with the spins here and here, in such a way that we come together at the central station. And sometimes they come at the same time, they don't get lost, and whenever they don't get lost and moreover get detected by this Bell state measurement, this is the heralding announcing that the two diamonds are entangled. And only in these cases we are going to keep the results. But in each case, we produce some random numbers at Alice and Bob's side, and then according to this result, perform some measurement that finishes on time, so before light had time to go from Alice to Bob or from Bob to Alice. And then we keep this result, so whenever we get this heralding signal in the middle. And we get this beautiful result. Essentially, they get a violation of the Bell inequality, the CHSH Bell inequality. So was that an experiment that one had to do? Well, I think, again, it is a fair statement to say that exceptional predictions, like quantum non-locality, require exceptional tests. So this is really a very beautiful result, and I'm extremely happy to have seen the first loophole-free test of Bell inequalities. You know, when I learned about Bell inequality 35 years ago, it was from a paper from Clauser and Shimoni that was mentioning these loopholes, but at that time, closing especially the detection loophole, but closing the both loopholes, locality and detection at the same time, was simply unthinkable. And now it has been done. And lots of press release on that, although the paper is not yet out. And that leads naturally to device-independent quantum key distribution. No? And we certainly all agree that this is a beautiful idea. It's also highly timely because of this first loophole-free Bell test. And certainly more of these tests are underway. However, I think also fair to say that it is still a long distance away from applications. You know, in this experiment in Delft, we had about 1 bit per hour. So in Geneva, we had a theorist, Nicolas Sangois, who was very inventive and was coming up with ideas of new experiments very frequently. And when you put numbers on it, you realize that the counts would be, I don't know, a few per hour, or sometimes even a fraction of a count per hour. So in Geneva, we invented a new unit, which I suggest we all adopt for these kind of problems, which is a sangoir. A sangoir meaning 1 count per hour. So that's where we are so far with this device-independent QKD, 1 sangoir per kilometer, for 1 kilometer. Okay. So research in device-independent QKD should certainly be reinforced, but it should not compete with today's applied QKD. Now you may say, I'm just saying that because I'm part of IDQ and I'm defending IDQ, but I think it's much deeper than that. Device-independent QKD may find applications in 10 years only, but it may find applications only if QKD is not dead by then. And in 10 years, we have 10 years to prove ourselves. We don't have 20 years. If in 10 years it's the post-quantum that will have made by far the larger majority of the shares of the market, there will be no way in 10 years to come and say, oh, but now we have a better idea. Let's start and make a second change in the crypto infrastructure worldwide. That is not going to happen. So either it happens now, or it will not happen at all. On the other side, once we have quantum repeaters that require quantum memories, then this kind of scheme, be it with the diamonds or being with some other schemes, any device-independent QKD scheme will be highly relevant because in any case, when we have quantum repeaters, we'll require entanglement. Let me also tell you why you should never buy your QKD system from Eve. Is Arthur still in the room? Hopefully. Sleeping. Ah, gone. Okay, so this is the usual scheme that you have. You have Alice and Bob in two safe locations, and for a while they open a door to let some quantum stuff go in and out. Then they close the door again, and then they choose their inputs and collect their data, both on Alice and Bob's side. Now, how do we choose these inputs? Actually, we have some random number generator, and we better have some quantum one. But actually, this one you have to trust. So you cannot put in the box. You have to put it outside the box. And then, once you have this result, you need also to communicate them and have some classical information processing that allows you to compute this Bell state parameter, that is this Bell parameter that has to be larger for 2 for CHSH. But this, again, you have to trust. If you don't trust the computer, you cannot do that. So the computer actually is also out of the box. So if you look at that now, the only part which is untrusted is this part. What comes in has to be trusted, what comes out has to be trusted, and the communication here has to be trusted. So implementing really a box that you could ship around and that implements device-independent QKD is certainly not easy, and it's not really a black box. You cannot sell a black box to a banker and tell him, oh, when the green light goes on, it's safe. That is just impossible. No? The only thing you can test, and you have to be a physicist to do that, is the quantum part, or the optical part, if you like. Moreover, if you put some real distance, let's suppose you put tens of kilometers here, then just the losses in this fiber, even if you use the best fiber from Corning or from any other producer, will be too large for device-independent QKD. So you need some heralding signal. Eva, as we did it in Delft, it was a shorter distance, but we already had more than the losses on the fiber they had was already too much. So they had the need for this heralding. And in general, you need something which is a heralded qubit amplifier. I'm not going to elaborate on that. But this leads us to semi-device-independent QKD. Semi-device-independent, it's not fully device-independent. You need some assumption, but maybe well-characterized assumptions. And here I like to present one idea that we developed in Geneva with my student Gilles Putz, and actually Renato Renner, who is also co-supervising Gilles. And this is called MDL and LDL, measurement-dependent locality and limited detection locality. So you see here, you have your local hypothetical local variable, or you have Eve here that could influence the source, but possibly could also influence the input. That is why you have some measurement dependence, could influence the inputs on both sides, and could also influence the losses. So we put the losses here. Of course, it commutes. You could also have losses in the channel and everywhere, and also the detection inefficiency you can account for in these losses, again, on both sides. So the lambda would also possibly influence the losses. So lambda really determines, well, influence at least, the input, the detection probability, and the source. And now the assumption here is that for any possible lambda and any possible pairs of inputs, there is a lower bound, L, which is strictly positive, and an upper bound, H, which is smaller than 1. So there can be an influence of lambda on the inputs, but not a full control. And similarly, the probability of not getting a click for any possible input and lambda is lower bounded by eta min, which is strictly positive. So the local strategy can influence X and the detection, but in each one of the experiment, lambda does not fully determine all the measurement settings nor fully prevent detection. Now, if you do this mild assumption, and it's a well-qualified assumption that you buy or don't buy, then you can again derive Bell-like inequalities. And interestingly, of course, is that these Bell-like inequalities can be violated by quantum predictions. And you can even do an experiment. That's an experiment that was done in Nice. It's Nice also, but it's Nice University here. And you see, we replaced the switch that we had here by just a passive coupler. So half the time the photon will go one way, half the time the photon goes the other way. And then the input will just decide which pair of detector will be active. And if the photon goes to an inactive pair of detectors, you just don't get any results. So you have at best 50% efficiency detection here. But now we don't need here to have 100% or high efficient detection. All what we need is that the probability of getting a detection never drops to 0. And the result, I'm not going to elaborate on that, it's on the archive since last week here, is that if we only make the MDL assumption, then we get, according to this experiment, that provided lambda has a control over the input, which is larger than 9%, we again, we violate this inequality, so we get measurement-dependent non-locality. And the same for the limited detection. If this detection efficiency is lower bounded by 2.7%, then we also get limited detection non-locality. So we violate these inequalities, these bell-like inequalities that you find in the paper. Interesting is that in order to do that, you cannot use maximally entangled state. You have to use a source that produces here actually partially entangled state. Let me, to in the last few minutes, tell you a little bit about quantum memories. So you all remember quantum memory is something in which you can send a photon. In our case, it's a crystal dot with billions of ions. And the quantum state of this photon, once it is inside our crystal, is coded in a huge entangled state of billions of atoms, which I find fascinating in itself. But that's not enough. You have also to be able to have the photon coming out again on demand. And let me stress that without quantum memories, there are no quantum repeaters. So whenever you hear someone speaking of quantum repeaters, and we had one person this morning, I'll let you guess who that was, talking about quantum repeaters without quantum memory, it is a contradiction in terms. There is nothing like that. You need memories for the synchronization in the repeater. And here is an example of what you can do. So first, instead of having just one quantum memory, we have actually two quantum memories, one which will store vertically polarized photons and one which stores horizontally polarized photons. And now we have a source here that produces HH, so horizontal-horizontal, plus VV. And one wavelength is targeted to the quantum memory wavelength, and the other one is a telecom wavelength. Now, whenever, so here, one thing you can do is just to do a Bell inequality test. Okay, not closing any loophole here, but just doing it. And so at some point, you really have non-local correlation between the qubit in the quantum memory and these flying photons. And for the specialist, let me just emphasize that this was done in 10 minutes compared to what we had, most people have, some times ago. Again, this is a huge progress. It's much faster and more reliable. And you see the visibilities are everywhere in the 90s. You can also consider the case where this measurement is performed first, and then that actually, of course, triggers a single photon on that side or heralds a single photon on that side. And in this case, you have that these two crystals get entangled, provided you detect here, for instance, at 45 degrees, when you have entanglement between these two crystals. You can also use it for teleportation. So you come with your qubit to be teleported to this partial Bell state measurement, and then you add some kilometers of fibers, and you see that the fidelity, when you add this almost 25 kilometer distance, is essentially unaffected. Right? It's in the noise, you don't see the difference. So this is a long-distance quantum teleportation, where the long distance is the difficult distance. Usually in quantum teleportation, the distance which is made long is this one, but that's the easy one, because here you just send one photon to a distance. That's pretty easy, especially when you add telecom wavelength. But here it is difficult, because you have to have that the two photons overlap on this beam splitter, remaining indistinguishable. You can also now do a complete quantum storage protocol in which you really transfer in the quantum coherence to the ground state, to the hyperfine ground state of these ions in the crystal, and then do with RF pulses some spin echo. And doing this spin echo, you see here an echo after half a millisecond about, still coming clearly out of the noise. And if you go to 1 millisecond, you are about at 2-3% efficiency still. So you can start go to a millisecond regime and no longer just nano or microsecond regimes for the memory times. Sorry, and here I wanted to say that also a quantum memory with a vision of 1 second is certainly on the horizon, that's coming. However, this is a picture of our source. Okay, also the students working on that, Christoph Clausen and Alexei? Tiranov, thank you. Alexei Tiranov. So we are working mostly on this source, and you see on the picture here, It is a star. Very simple. But in the lab, it looks like that. So when I tell you, there's no way to put that in a box and ship it around. Not today. Hopefully in 10 years. But it's not for today. So let me come to the conclusion. And the main points, maybe the take-home messages, are the ones in red here. The quantum technology revolution is taking off. Good news. But it, of course, comes with demands. A gigabit per second QKD engine is on the horizon. Everybody needs quantum random number generator. Device-independent QKD is a beautiful idea, but we should not oversell it. Okay, thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you, Nicolas. We have 5 minutes for questions.
Gilles?
Renato?
Okay. You were talking about random numbers, and there you were emphasizing the fact that we can get a statement about Kolmogorov complexity. And now my question is, are there applications where it's really the Kolmogorov complexity that is actually relevant, or is it not rather the unpredictability that makes, let's say, the random numbers useful?
Yeah. Okay, of course you know the answer very well, and of course you're absolutely right, it's the unpredictability, but that brings me back to this idea that what is really relevant is to have random processes, because in a random process it's exactly like that. So that is really what you need, is a random process, which means a process that produces bits or dits, whatever, which are unpredictable for everyone.
So maybe the question was just what was the reason to, let's say,
describe it in terms of Kolmogorov complexity? Because the mathematicians, they always talk about that. Now, for the mathematicians, the definition of randomness means Kolmogorov complexity. And I think this is exactly where from which we should move away. Okay. And in physics, that's exactly what we're doing. And we should not be ashamed of moving away. It's a plus, but to move away.
So you mentioned it because we shouldn't. Okay. Yeah.
Yes, Nicolas. Several times in your talk, you compared post-quantum crypto and QKD and somehow opposed a bit them to and asked who will win. And I must say, it's more a comment, but I'm not very comfortable with this opposition. And wouldn't it be maybe more fruitful to, for our community to say that maybe if in 10 years we have technology for security, for practical security that mix quantum features with complexity, it would be already fine. Maybe it's not QKD, but maybe if we ask QKD to win over post-quantum crypto, we have already lost, right? So maybe we should ask the question another way.
Well, here, I'm not sure I completely agree. There are always these two parts. There is distributing keys, where you use either a classical system or a quantum system, and then what you do with the key. And what you do with the key will be classical in any case. It's AES or something else, or you can develop, we'll hear about also quantum digital signatures and so on. But there are the solutions that use a bit of quantumness, and there are the solutions that use no quantum at all. And there is no way, it's either we use quantum or we don't use it. We cannot use it half a quantum. You cannot divide it. It's quantum. So I think there is indeed a tension today, and I think we should not hide that fact. There is a big tension between our community that clearly would like to use quantum physics and the majority, the last majority of the classical crypto community, this post-quantum cryptography community, which would much prefer not to hear about quantum at all, not even usually for a randomness generation.
All right, we have only 1.5 minutes left and 2 questions already declared. So, Lev?
I just would like clarification. We have a finite string, we cannot know it's random. But you said that we have some way to know if the process is random.
Yes.
We need infinite time for this, or we just need to know how it was built? How you know that the process is random? You cited some theorem, but... Well, operationally, what you do, I give you a machine, how you know that the process is random?
Well, yeah, of course, it is a theorem, so you have assumptions. And one of the assumptions is no signaling. And once you have no signaling and you have Bell inequality violation, then you know that you have a random process.
But again, Bell inequality, maybe I'm just lucky. It maybe well, okay, just, it's also the same. It's the same story, the same, the finite data. Maybe you're just lucky.
No, but in order to convince ourselves that entanglement exists and that quantum non-locality exists or the possibility of violating Bell inequality exists, it is you don't need to look at one very specific sequence. It is a general analysis of physics in general, and once you are convinced by quantum theory in general and by its specific prediction of entanglement, non-locality, and randomness, then you have your source of randomness. And each time you use it, you don't need to go back to the entire analysis and to infinitely large samples to evaluate whether your data violates some Bell inequality. Well, if you have just a sequence, there's nothing to which you can on which you can fall back to guarantee that this specific given sequence, I give you a sequence of 1,000 bits, I give it to you, what can you do with that? There's nothing behind that that will guarantee that this specific sequence is random or not random. There's just no way even to answer the question, because with 1,000, if it would be a billion, it's the same. You cannot know whether it is random or not.
But then the word finite, if you somehow
time is up, really. And perhaps if it's really, really brief, no? All right. So thanks again, Nicolas, and
thank you.
We'll move to the next talk.